In Elden Ring, the control over the production of new life, of new births, is of paramount importance to its major political players. In our own world, attempts to control this power have a truly ancient and evidently everlasting legacy. Take, for example, the practice of prima nocta, the supposed right of a lord to spend the first night with a new bride, which at least as a story has its origins in the literal oldest written story of history, the Epic of Gilgamesh. And similar practices are attested to in the very first work of history from the ancient Greek Herodotus. Its persistence as a legend in medieval Europe, today scholars don't think this practice was ever truly a law, attests to the enduring nature of these concerns. And sure enough, even today, these struggles play out in the political debates over birth control, abortion, in vitro fertilization, among others. And in Elden Ring, it's no different. The fight over who gets to control new birth in the lands between is no less acrimonious. When we asked in our Mikola video, what makes a god, we meant it mostly rhetorically, as a way to introduce the potential power of Mikola and his ultimately stillborn new age. But Elden Ring, though it is a bit opaque with the details, is actually quite specific about what being a god actually means. Being a god means taking a consort, your lord, and being a vessel for the Elden Ring, literally housed in your body, and producing new life by wielding its power. Though, just who is in control of this power is another matter entirely. The Elden Ring and the Erd Tree are used to produce new life in the lands between. We won't bore you with the details of this process because we've covered it extensively in our Cycle of Life trilogy, which you should check out if you're curious. But suffice it to say that the concept of a genealogy tree was taken to absurd realism. People are literally born from the power of the Erd Tree, or at least they were, back when things functioned properly in the Age of Plenty. And after people die, they are resorbed into its roots. It's a nice little arboreal circle of life, and seems to predominantly be Mariacka's innovation. So let's continue this a bit further, shall we? The game makes it very clear that, essentially, what makes a god is being the one to exert control over this process of life and death. Mariacka's bedchamber is at the head of the Tree of Yashai. Her bedchamber is designed to collect sap blessings from the Erd Tree, and when we finally meet her, her torso, including her womb, has been replaced by the Elden Ring. The only purpose now of her body is for someone else's designs. But how does one actually go about becoming a god? Well, we are told, candidates for the job are selected by the two fingers, and given the designation of Empyrean, essentially god-in-waiting. We know of six demigods remaining, three of which are Empyreans. Of course, there's quite a bit of debate about what precisely defines an Empyrean, including some ambiguous phrasing of Melania's remembrance. But let's just simplify things a bit. The Empyreans are all women, or at least they seem capable of bearing children. Ranni, Melania, and Mikola, or at least Mikola's alter ego Saint Trina, all have wombs, and therefore are capable of being vessels for the Elden Ring. Mikola is a special case we know, not typically thought of as female, but clearly, at least, he does not have stereotypically male characteristics, with his perpetual youth, his feminine alter ego, and the fact that his throne in the Halig Tree roots is a literal female pelvis, something which is then replicated in the Mogwin Dynasty mausoleum. He's even sitting side saddle in the DLC announcement image, if that is indeed him, a stance traditionally associated with feminine riders. Even the Empyreans from the past age, Marika and the Glow-Eyed Queen, are of course also women. Of course, Marika is all about producing new births, her very own blessings of the Erd Tree, but so was the Glow-Eyed Queen, evidently, according to the Godskin swaddling cloth, which strongly implies that the Godskin apostles are her children. Compare all these known Empyreans to the other demigods, Rykard, Godric, Radahn, Morgott, and Moog. No matter how strong they get, think of Radahn in particular, mightiest of the demigods, they are not eligible for being Empyreans because, well, they simply are not the right sex. But speaking of the opposite sex, they do in fact play a role in this tango, don't worry. You see, for as clear as the game is about what makes a god, it's equally clear about what makes a lord. Godfrey went from being a warrior to being Elden Lord when he married Marika, just as Radagon after him went from being a mere champion to, quote, king consort, end quote. Consummating a union with a god is what makes you a lord. If you have any doubts about this, Ranni's Dark Moon Ring is even more explicit, as it reads, quote, Ranni is an Empyrean, meaning her consort would by rights earn the title of lord, end quote. In other words, whoever becomes consort to an Empyrean becomes a lord. And the flip side is also true. We are told that Moog wishes to raise Mikala to, quote, full godhood, end quote, by becoming his consort. So it, in the end, is quite clear. An Empyrean becomes a god by taking a consort, and that consort becomes Elden Lord. It's all about this pairing of god and lord, because ultimately, it's all about childbirth. Even Rykard, in his own special way, is adhering to these rules. Rykard goes from being a praetor to being a lord because he feeds himself to, aka he marries, the serpent god. This is not the first time FromSoft have equated marriage to offering oneself to a giant serpent. As in Sekiro, the act is even more explicitly a marriage ceremony. In Rykard's case, he only becomes a Lord of Blasphemy after he offers himself to the Serpent God. And the product of their union is the birth of the Serpent Men, as is made clear by their ashes, which read, quote, It is said that long ago the Elder Serpent that dwelled on Mount Gelmir devoured a demigod, and the birth of the Man-Serpents followed, end quote. And as we've discussed in other episodes, the Serpent's Amnion in Igle's temple clearly refers to a, quote, repellent birthing ritual, end quote, one that actually produced Rhea and her kind, and is no doubt a heretical cycle of life wherein human sacrifices are offered to the Serpent God, and man-serpents are born in return, becoming one big, not-so-happy family. In fact, Lady Tanith's lie about Raya's heritage may not be so much of a lie after all. When Rhea says, quote, I am told I was born by the grace of a glorious king, end quote, she may be partially correct. She is the product of Lord Rykard's marriage to the Serpent God. Once again, what defines a god and what defines a lord is quite clear. So far, this is all a bit weird, sure, but overall not too dissimilar from political marriages in our own world's history, where formal titles were offered in exchange for control over birthing rights and the creation of a dynastic lineage. But, as we will see, things take a much darker turn once you realize who is really in control of this process. Let's return to the case of Moog and Mikala. First off, what does Moog actually intend to do with Mikala? Well, let's look at the evidence. First, his remembrance says, quote, Wishing to raise Mikala to full godhood, Moog wished to become his consort, taking the role of monarch. But no matter how much of his bloody bedchamber he tried to share, he received no response from the young Empyrean, end quote. So from this, as we alluded to before, we can assume that he means to consummate a union with Mikola. No matter that Mikola is asleep or even possibly dead, that won't stop the lusty Moog. All Moog wants is to use the power of Mikola's Empyrean blood and title to produce a new dynasty. It goes without saying that you don't produce a new dynasty without consummating the union. And regarding his so-called, quote, bloody bedchamber, end quote, the real-world parallels are unfortunately quite clear, with menstrual blood being viewed as the first sign of a girl's sexual maturity, and a literal bloody bedchamber being used as a sign that the marriage has been consummated, assuming the bride was previously a virgin. Not coincidentally, the reason that girls, and indeed Mikola, used to ride side saddle on horses was to protect their hymen, and therefore the proof that they were in fact still virgins. So Moog is not exactly hiding his intentions, as disturbing as they may be. Credit to Reddit user Moonslippers for an excellent post on these two a few months back, which we recommend you checking out, but here we'll just mention an idea that Moonslippers had, which suggests that Moog's formless mother is actually in and of itself a reference to a womb, a negative space or cavity that can produce new life. Once again, the marital union is all about childbirth, and Moog wants to become a lord, or monarch, of Mikola's new age by producing a new dynastic lineage with him. So with that unpleasant image in mind, and Marika's ultimate fate as essentially a baby maker for the Elden Beast, is it any wonder that Ranni opted out of this whole exploitation racket? Ranni's rebellion against the Two Fingers makes a lot of sense if you consider what acquiescence would mean. Just like medieval marriages, and indeed often modern ones too, it would be an arrangement fundamentally not under her control, and would lead her to being used for nothing more than just her womb. So it's not just ideology that leads her to want an order that is far removed from the lands between. Ranni wants no part of this exploitative baby racket. And though, of course, we can't prove this, if you search your feelings, you'll know it to be true. Godwin the Golden was probably her betrothed, so her role in the Night of the Black Knives and Godwin's murder is all the more poignant. And speaking of that night, the result of that dual half-murder was, in her words, to slay her own Empyrean flesh. She says,
"But I would not acquiesce to the Two Fingers. I stole the rune of death, slew mine own Empyrean flesh. Casting it away, I would not be controlled by that thing."
Slaying her flesh makes total sense, since she's slaying the mechanism by which the Greater Will and the Two Fingers could control her. The divine baby-making golden goose, so to speak. When she says, "I would not be controlled by that thing," it's a brilliant double entendre. It seems at first as though she's just referring to the control of the Two Fingers, but equally, she could be referring to her own body, a body that would have been used as a means to control her. So, she sacrificed her own body in order to gain independence. So, those are the candidates for Marika's succession, but how about the current order? As Melna puts it,
"However ruined this world has become, however mired in torment and despair, life endures. Births continue. There is beauty in that, is there not? If you would become Lord, do not deny this notion, please."
She very clearly links the current order with new births, and asks that, if you do become the new Elden Lord, essentially becoming Marika's new consort, that you preserve these new births. And so then the question is, what is the current order? Marika's first dynastic lineage was the Golden Lineage, the line which she produced with Godfrey and with the power of the Elden Ring and Sap Baptisms. But the Golden Lineage failed. Godwin, scion of the Golden Bough, crown prince of the Golden Lineage, was murdered, as with presumably many other Golden Lineage demigods on that night. And all that was left of the lineage was a runt and two omens. So Marika needed a plan B, and that plan B was to exert utter control over the process, by not just remarrying, but by fusing with her new consort, such that they could produce new births through self-fertilization. Marika says through Melina that, quote, "The Erd Tree governs all. The choice is thine. Become one with the Order, or divest thyself of it. To wallow at the fringes, a powerless upstart," end quote. Who is she talking to here? It's impossible to say with certainty, but it seems likely that she's talking to Godfrey, as the reference to a powerless upstart at the fringes is a likely reference to how Godfrey started as the simple warrior Horalu. Godfrey, or we should say Hora, is the one character in the game who feels complete, who feels he is whole by himself. As explained wonderfully by a couple of videos from Sinclair Lair, which we recommend you check out. As an example, he becomes fully himself again, and in fact gets much stronger, when he tears Sarash from his back. Contrast this to Godrick, who is so woefully incomplete that he needs to graft others onto himself in order to acquire their strength. So how would Godfrey have responded when Marika asked him to become one with the Order? What that means precisely is up for debate, but we know she eventually found someone who was willing to become one with the Order, to fuse, and that someone was Radagon. Again, as expertly explained by Sinclair Lore, Radagon is defined by his incompleteness. He is constantly striving, by studying both sorceries and miracles, to, quote, be complete, end quote, as his icon puts it. So while Godfrey would have refused the ultimatum to fuse with Marika, perhaps that's the reason he was tarnished, then Radagon would definitely have accepted. And the fusion would produce a lord and a god together in one body, capable of self-fertilization, or autogamy in more general terms. Not only is this something that fits quite well with the game's botanical obsessions, as many species of plant are indeed capable of self-fertilization, but it also has a rich mythological tradition. The rebus in the alchemical tradition is a divine hermaphrodite. By the way, certain animals, like roundworms, are actually hermaphrodites capable of self-fertilization as well. Athena, the wisest of all Greek gods, was, according to Hesiod at least, spawned by parthenogenesis from Zeus's head. Many of the earlier gods of the Greek pantheon reproduced asexually, and in some tellings of the story, the mighty Egyptian god Horus was produced by parthenogenesis, and so on. So there's clearly a rich tradition of producing new life by one's own self, so to speak. As for Marika, what better way to ensure complete control over the process of producing a new divine lineage than to be both consort and queen, both lord and god, together in one body? That was the plan at least, and it worked insofar as two, possibly three if you count Melina, divine children were born from this process. But each of them was flawed. Mikala and his eternal youth, Melania and her rot. Indeed, this is the predictable consequence of self-fertilization. It increases the likelihood of rare genetic conditions, and because it reduces genetic complexity, it increases the likelihood of a pathogen wiping out the population. But that is not the end of the story. Because when we find Mariacka, crucified by golden light, there is something else critical to the forensics of this crime scene. The murder weapon, so to speak, is a spear, seemingly made of destined death, driven through her abdomen. Of course, this is quite evocative of the Holy Lance, the spear that was supposedly driven through Jesus' side by a Roman soldier after he was crucified. But if you look more closely, there's an intriguing and, no doubt, deliberate difference between these two scenes. In the typical depiction of Jesus' crucifixion, the Holy Lance pierces him higher up, just below the nipple at the mid-clavicular line. And in fact, the relevant line in John's Gospel states that he was pierced in his pleura, usually translated as side, but in Greek, pleura just means rib, again indicating he was pierced higher up. But in Mariacka's case, the spear is much lower, and at the midline, close to the navel. Before we get any smart-aleck lectures on female anatomy, sure, it's not exactly where the womb would be, but it's quite close. And the deliberate decision by the developers to change the location of the wound from that of Jesus' crucifixion has one clear implication. Whoever put that spear in her intended to take away her power to gestate new life. There are two events in this scene. One, an eternal imprisonment by a golden crucifixion, and another, a piercing of the divine womb. As Ennia says,
Mariacka's trespass demanded a heavy sentence, but even in shackles, she remains a god and a vision's vessel.
In other words, Mariacka remained a vessel for the birthing power of the Elden Ring, even after she was crucified. What mattered to the greater will was her body, her womb, not her agency. That is, of course, until someone pierced her womb. As to who that was and why, well, that is a story for another day.